The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... If I may paraphrase the title of a beautiful old ballad, the song is over, but the memory lingers on. Yes. Long after we have forgotten the words, and even the melody, the memory of the music, and what it may have meant to us, still lingers. And it stays with us long after the song is over, the day is over, the love affair is over, and especially after the murder is over.
What is it you want to tell me?
The only way to say it, I suppose, is to say it. I'm leaving you.
No, Edward.
I'm sorry, Rosalind.
You sold yourself to me. I own you, body and soul.
This is the 20th century. I'm not your chattel. There's nothing you can do about it.
There isn't?
Is that gun your idea of a joke?
There's nothing funny about a revolver. You walk out on me, and I'll kill you.
Drama, The Twelfth Juror, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Sam Dan and stars Marian Seldes. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Is it the French who have that saying? In each affair, there is the one who loves and the one who is loved. You know. The fact remains that it's all too often true. And it's also true that while two people may fall in love with each other at the same time, no such neat and convenient scheduling can govern their falling out of love with each other. I'm sure you'll agree, and I hope it's not from personal experience, that this may cause a great many problems.
Edward! Darling, you're late.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Well, you're just going to stand there in the doorway.
Oh.
I'm all packed and ready.
Yes, I see.
A drink before we leave?
All right.
Well, you know where everything is and how to mix mine. Well, Edward?
Yes?
You don't notice anything?
No.
Well, look closely.
I.
Is this what happens after a while? We look at the loved one, but we really do not see. Or does this mean I am no longer your loved one?
Your hair?
Oh, Edward, you are absolutely impossible. I found it.
Yes?
The butterfly.
The butterfly? Oh!
Yes! You bought it for me and you don't even remember?
I do. It was at Lake Rebajo.
Oh, you silly. It was at Lake Mara.
Yes, it was at Lake Mara.
And remember how I scolded you for spending so much money? I thought I'd lost it. And then this morning I was going through some drawers, and there it was, this adorable golden butterfly. See?
Yes.
And I'll never put it away again. I'll wear it always with everything. Shall we go? Are we ready?
I suppose so.
Let's be off.
I think I'll have another drink.
Oh, is that wise? It's quite a long drive.
Well, then I won't have another drink.
Out? You know I'm right.
Yes, you're always right.
What does that mean?
Nothing.
Oh, you're always so nervous at the beginning of each trip. Well, it's a beautiful place, and it's very much out of the way. We won't run into anyone we know, and she'll never find out.
It isn't that.
No, then what is it?
Your phone is ringing.
Oh, let it. Yeah.
Rosalind, there are times when...
There are times when what?
Rosalind, the phone.
I don't care about the phone.
Well, a ringing telephone makes me nervous.
All right. Hello?
Mrs. Wallace?
Who is this?
Alfred Graham, Mrs. Wallace.
What do you want?
I have to talk to you.
We have nothing to talk about.
Mrs. Wallace, I have a wife and children.
You also had a wife and children when you stole my money.
No, please. Please, give me a chance.
Why?
Because from now on, I'll be the most trustworthy, the most reliable employee you could ever have. I've learned... learned a terrible lesson. I've been through the fire. I've suffered. In a few years, I'll have found a way to pay you back.
I'm sorry.
What does the money mean to you, anyhow? You have so much.
Just because I have a great deal of money, does that give you the license to steal?
I thought I could pay it back.
You were greedy and stupid.
Yes, yes, I was. I confess. Oh, look, I can't go to prison. I'll be disgraced.
That is your problem, Alfred.
I can't face it. I'll kill myself.
As I just said, Alfred, it's your problem.
No, I mean it. I'll kill myself.
Good night, Alfred. Where were we, Edward?
Who was that?
Nobody.
No, tell me.
Oh, an auditor with one of my real estate companies. I caught him with his hand in the till.
And he was asking you, I gather, for a chance to redeem himself.
Well, it doesn't matter.
He was desperate. I heard him say he was going to kill himself.
I don't think he will.
I do.
Oh, why are we even talking about it? Do you realize that you didn't even kiss me when you came in?
I heard that tone in his voice. That man is going to commit suicide.
Well, he has that option if he chooses.
What are you saying?
I'm saying it's time we were on our way.
You mean that you and I will just go off and enjoy ourselves even while we know another human being is about to lose his life?
Oh, people are always losing their lives all over the world.
But this is one life you could save.
I'm not the one who's holding a gun to his head.
Rosalind, there's a basic morality here.
Morality? Are you going to preach about morality? You are as immoral as I am.
No.
You just haven't learned to accept it. But you will.
Never.
What if Sheila were to find out about us?
Sheila knows.
About you and me?
She doesn't know who it is specifically, but she knows there's somebody.
When did she find out?
I think she always knew.
Well, that's good. Then she's had time to become accustomed to it.
We talked, Sheila and I, and she's decided to forgive me.
Oh, how noble.
Provided I promised to end the affair.
Oh.
And I swore to her that I would.
Oh. But you still made the reservations for this weekend.
Yes, yes, I did.
And was this to be our final fling?
Well, until just now, I was afraid to face you with it, but what just happened, this telephone call, made me realize something.
Yes? What?
That you're an evil woman.
Am I evil to you? Am I? Don't I bring you something you can't get from your wife?
Let's leave Sheila out of this.
Oh, yes, of course, let's leave her in her wheelchair. And so, therefore, don't you come to me for fulfillment, for pleasure? Don't you admit it?
Yes.
Well, then, what's your complaint?
I'm committing adultery.
Well, you've been committing it for the last 7 years.
Well, I want to stop it.
You could have stopped it any time you chose. You could have divorced Sheila and married me.
How can I divorce Sheila? She's helpless.
But the fact is, she cannot be a wife to you. In the complete sense of the word.
I want this relationship of yours and mine to end.
And how do you propose to live without me? You make out rather poorly selling stocks and bonds. Without the money I so adroitly managed to give you, I don't...
Sheila and I will get by.
Edward, I do not choose to end this relationship.
Rosalind.
This furtive little relationship. This tawdry secret affair.
There's nothing more.
Oh, shut up, Edward. You belong to me. You're bought and paid for.
Rosalind, let me go quietly. Look at me. I'm not very much.
You're enough for me.
Rosalind, you're an attractive woman. A wealthy woman. You could do so much better.
Well, you are what I want, and I intend to keep you.
No. I'm leaving.
You are not going to walk out on me, Edward. No one walks out on Rosalind Wallace.
Yeah, I am not your chattel.
Yes, you are. You sold yourself to me, body and soul, and I do not choose to release you.
There isn't anything you can do about it.
Isn't there? Here it is.
Is this your idea of a joke?
No. There's nothing funny about a revolver.
Are you trying to threaten me?
I never threaten, Edward. I state a fact. If you walk out on me, I'll kill you. What are you laughing at?
You won't pull that trigger.
Why not?
You're too shrewd a businesswoman, and this is just a bad deal.
Oh, is it?
You shoot me, you'll spend the rest of your life in jail. Is it worth it?
Yes.
I don't believe you.
Don't take another step, I'll kill you.
No, you won't. Goodbye, foolish Rosalind.
Goodbye.
Rosalind!
You didn't believe me.
You won't get away with it.
Why didn't you believe me?
You won't get away with it.
Edward.
Edward!
Why don't I feel anything? Sorrow. Remorse. Maybe you're right, Edward. Maybe I am evil, but I can't help that. You asked for it, Edward. But I won't go to prison. I can't. I'd be disgraced. Who said that? Who just said that? What? Oh. Yes. Yes. I will get away with it, Edward, despite what you said. I will get away with it. You'll see. I know just how.
Yes, hello.
Alfred, this is Mrs. Wallace.
Yes, Mrs. Wallace, yes.
I want you to come over to my place right away.
Yes, yes, of course, Mrs. Wallace, certainly, immediately.
I got you just as fast as I could, Mrs. Wallace.
Come inside, Alfred.
I even broke the speed limit. Why, what happened? That man lying there on the floor, he's lacked blood. Is he dead?
Yes.
Dead? Oh, how?
He was shot.
Who shot him?
You did.
Me?
Yes, Alfred. You.
But that's impossible.
Sit down, Alfred.
But sit down? Why?
Because I say so.
Now, just hold on.
Yes?
A man's been murdered.
Yes, that's obvious.
That means we have to call the police.
We will, Alfred. We are going to do that very thing.
But when?
Just as soon as you decide to confess.
Oh, why? Why should I confess to a murder I didn't commit?
Oh, I think I can convince you, Alfred. I know I can convince you. You would have to do some mighty tall convincing to convince me. But then I'm not Elsa Graham. And it must be said that she's quite the convincer, this Mrs. Rosalind Waller. She also seems to surround herself with rather weak and pliable men. While we know that Alfred is weak, can he be that pliable? As usual, the answer is revealed in the second act shortly. It wrote, the buyer needs 1,000 eyes, the seller needs but one. Buying and selling, in a basic sense, that could pretty well be what this world is all about, no? Every day, in a multitude of ways, some large, some small, each of us is presented with an opportunity to make one sort of deal or another, aren't we? Someone is always willing to sell us something or other in exchange for our time, our labor, our love, or our immortal soul. And how can you tell if it's a bargain? Well, the Romans had a phrase for it. Caveat emptor. Let the buyer beware.
You want me to confess to a murder I didn't commit?
Yes.
Well, I beg your pardon, Mrs. Wallace, but are you crazy?
No.
Well, then how could you even think that I would...
Because it would be the sensible thing for you to do. Sensible, practical, prudent. And I might add, far-sighted.
A man is lying dead on the floor, and there's the gun. You killed him.
Of course, but only you and I shall ever know that.
Well, I'm going to call the police, and he'll arrest you for murder.
And what will you gain by that?
Well, I'll have the satisfaction of knowing that a woman like you, a cold, cruel, unfeeling woman, will be sent to prison.
And will that be satisfaction enough for you, Alfred?
Yes.
Now just think. You will also be in prison. You've been caught stealing. What will become of your wife and your children? You have no savings. They'll have no income. You'll lose your home and your car and everything you own. How will they live? And finally, when you'll be freed, your reputation will have been destroyed. So who'll hire you or trust you with money?
I'll still have the satisfaction of seeing
now,
you...
Now, shut up a minute.
You're in no position to order me
Listen
around.
Listen to me, you fool, before I lose my patience. Regardless of what happens to me, you will go to jail. I have proof of your embezzlement. I have the false documents, the forged checks.
But
So confess to this killing.
To save your neck?
To save your own.
How? I'll go to jail for murder instead of embezzlement and forgery. Oh, no, no, thank you.
You will be well paid for it.
Paid? But my reputation will still be destroyed.
Your reputation is gone in any case. We're talking about your wife and your children. Are they worth saving?
Well, how
I'll save them for you.
You? You're what?
I will, one, pay off the mortgage on your house. Two, I'll set up a trust fund to send each child through college. And three, each month I will send your wife a check for one half the salary you've been receiving.
Half?
Two-thirds.
But
well, listen, you're in no position to bargain. Take it or leave it.
In
addition, I shall pay for the best legal counsel to defend you. I'm sure they'll come up with a most sympathetic defense. Who knows, you may wind up serving less time for murder than you might have for embezzlement. Well?
I don't
believe... Well, we've run out of time, Alfred. I need your answer now.
Well, I... Let's say I... Well, I mean, how would this thing work?
Now, don't worry. I'll create the proper story. Now, the first thing I have to do is pick up this gun and wipe off my fingerprints. There. Now, I hand you the gun so that you can place yours.
My fingerprints.
If you fired the gun, then naturally it would show your fingerprints, wouldn't it?
Yes. No, wait. How do I know you'll keep your end of the bargain?
You've worked for me for 15 years. Now, in that time, did you ever know me to break my word?
Well,
I've always tried to get the best of every deal. That's true. But have I ever lied?
No.
All right. Now, take the gun.
No.
No? Take it.
And confess to a murder I didn't commit?
You have no choice.
Oh, my wife, my children, they'll think I'm a murderer.
Well, at least they'll think so in a warm house with full stomach.
I don't want them to believe
What's more important, your vanity or their welfare? Take the gun. That's it. Good. Now grasp it firmly. Fine. Now let it fall to the floor. Now, sit down.
What are you going to do?
Watch. Hello? Oh, police emergency. There's been a murder at my home. I'm Mrs. Rosalind Wallace, 86 Harrison Crescent. Yes.
What are we going to say to the police?
You are not going to say anything. You are going to be in a state of shock.
Lieutenant Muller, Chuck. The man's name is Allbritton. Edward Donald Allbritton. He's dead. Looks like one shot through the heart. You can send the lab people over and get the routine started. Yeah, right. Now, you. What's your name? What's your name?
Lieutenant, you can see the man is in a state of shock.
Do you know his name?
Alfred Graham.
And he fired the shot?
Yes.
You know him?
He's an employee of mine.
What's the name of your firm?
Wallace Enterprises.
And the dead man? You knew him, too?
Not really.
What does not really mean?
Casually.
Yes?
He worked for a brokerage house, and he'd call on me from time to time to try to sell me stocks and bonds, various investments.
What was he doing here tonight?
He'd phoned me. He was in the neighborhood. He told me he had a special situation that I simply couldn't afford to overlook, and could he come over and make a presentation? Well, you never know, so I said yes.
And what time did he get here?
About 6. We started to discuss it, and then I heard a noise in the next room in the library. I was afraid it was a burglar, and I wanted to call the police, and he said, oh, nonsense, let me handle this.
Yes?
Well, chap. I guess he really wanted to impress me. Before I could stop him, he'd run into the library in here. I heard some words, and
then a shot. I looked through the open door, and I saw poor Mr. Alberton lying on the floor, and Alfred Graham just standing over him.
Alfred Graham had shot Edward Alberton. Why?
I asked him, but he couldn't answer. He was in the same state of shock he's in now. But I didn't have to ask, really, because I knew why.
Was there something between these two?
No. I suppose it all has to come out.
What does?
Oh, I wish I didn't have to mention it. Alfred Graham has been stealing from my company. He's even forged my name on several checks, and recently I confronted him, and I told him I had the evidence. So I suppose he was desperate. He must have come here to try to find it, the evidence, and destroy it. And while he was rummaging through the drawers of my desk, he came upon that revolver that you see there on the floor.
Yes?
Well, it's registered in my name. I have a license for it.
Go on, Mrs. Wallace.
I said he was desperate. I suppose he thought if he couldn't destroy the evidence, perhaps he could destroy me. But Mr. Alberton fought with him, and Alfred Graham killed him. Poor Alfred, I mean, at heart, he really isn't a murderer. And as you can see, the realization of what he's done, it's just too much for him.
Well, I guess it's all pretty much open and shut.
Do you remember, Rosalind? We went to that summer theater, and we saw Shakespeare's Macbeth.
Please go away. I'm asleep.
Don't you hear a voice cry, "Sleep no more, Rosalind Wallace"? Like Macbeth, you have murdered sleep.
Who is... Oh, thank goodness. Such a dream.
It's no dream.
I hear your voice.
Of course. You'll always hear my voice.
Edward, what do you want?
What do I want? You murdered me in cold blood, and you ask, what do I want?
I'm imagining this.
I'll tell you what I want. I want to make sure you don't forget what I told you as I lay there dying. Do you remember what I told you? I said you won't get away with it.
Edward, you're dead. The dead do not speak. Therefore, I'm just imagining all this.
I'm here to remind you, you will not get away with it, Rosalind.
Mrs. Wallace, the state has an ironclad case.
I know, Mr. Holling.
You'll even be called as a prosecution witness.
Yes.
According to the statement you made to the police detectives at the time of the murder, you actually saw him commit the crime.
Yes, that's true.
In addition, they have his signed confession and his fingerprints on the gun.
I realize that.
Well, I'm not being vain, but you don't really need an attorney in my experience. It's a lost cause.
But I feel an obligation. He's an employee of mine.
Even though he was robbing you.
Oh, he's been punished enough for that.
Well, no matter who defends him, he will be found guilty.
But you'll do your best for him.
Well, actually, all I can do is hope that the court will temper justice with mercy.
You've always been successful in getting the maximum amount of mercy for your clients, Mr. Holling.
Well, thank you. It's all a matter of selecting the right jury. Miss or Mrs.?
I'm a widow.
Are you employed, Mrs. Bennett?
Well, I'm a secretary at Collins and Parish.
And what do they do?
They're certified public accountants.
And how long have you worked there?
6 years.
And what did you do before that?
I was with My Lady's Choice.
Oh, what's that?
A chain of boutiques.
Located where?
In various resort hotels.
And what was your job?
I managed one of the stores.
Was that a better position than the one you have now?
Yes.
May I ask why you left?
I was fired.
Do you know the defendant, Alfred Grant?
No.
Do you feel that you can judge him conscientiously?
I do.
Your Honor, the 12th juror, Mrs. Sarah Jean Bennett, is acceptable to the defense.
Are you satisfied with your jury, Mr. Holmes?
Yes, I think we have a sympathetic group.
Are you sure?
Well, it's not an exact science, you know. I'll go with a gut feeling. You know, the one I like best is that Mrs. Bennett.
Why?
She has courage.
How can you tell?
Why did you leave your job? I was fired. Well, you see, she could have answered in a more face-saving, self-serving manner. But she's obviously a person who doesn't care what anyone thinks. And she is the holdout type.
What's that?
A juror who isn't afraid to be on the short end of an 11-to-1 ballot.
Oh.
In cases where it's 50-50, I would disqualify her. And she could hold out against me. But here, with a verdict practically assured before we ever begin, she could only hold out for me.
Despite all the evidence?
And if by some miracle she might be convinced somehow that Alfred Graham is not guilty, you could never get her to change her vote.
Oh?
Now, don't count on it. And chances of that are about 1 in 1,000,000.
Rosalind.
Oh, go away. Please let me sleep.
But you're not asleep, Rosalind.
Oh, please let me sleep.
You'll never sleep again for the rest of your life.
Edward. Edward.
Sarah Jean Bennett.
What is happening to me? I'm hearing things.
Sarah Jean Bennett. Juror number 12.
But what about Sarah Jean Bennett?
Think, Rosalind, think.
Let us all think. Suddenly we are confronted with a new character, and with what appears to be a new complication. Who is Sarah Jean Bennett? What possible effect can she have on our story? Well, you know us. We say fair. You already have enough clues to make a certain strategic deduction. We'll check it out in Act 3 shortly. All guilt, said Goethe, is punished upon this earth. Well, sometimes it is, and sometimes it isn't. And so far in our own story, we have a case where the guilty party would seem to have clear sailing. It's true that the dead man, the one she killed, keeps telling her that she won't get away with it. But we know there's nothing supernatural involved here. It's only the voice of her own conscience. Or is it?
Oh, Edward. What about Sarah Jean Bennett?
The name means nothing to you?
No.
You never heard it before?
Never.
Are you sure,
Rosamond? I have to stop this.
Stop what?
This is insane. Talking to myself.
You're not talking to yourself. You're talking to me, Edward.
You are dead.
Of course I'm dead.
I must pull myself together.
Didn't I tell you you wouldn't get away with it?
Oh, shut up!
Sarah Jean Bennett will give me justice.
Who is Sarah Jean Bennett?
Juror number 12.
Sarah Jean Bennett, juror number 12.
The holdout juror.
Oh, what are you talking about, Edward? Edward? Please, Edward, let me get some sleep.
Mr. Graham, why did you go to Mrs. Wallace's home?
I wanted to find some documents.
And did you?
No.
And while you were looking for them?
A man came running into the room and we had a fight.
And what happened?
I shot him.
With what?
A revolver.
Now tell me, did you bring that revolver with you?
No. No, I found it in Mrs. Wallace's desk.
And so you came there unharmed. You did not plan to kill anyone.
No, I'm afraid I just lost my head. I'm sorry.
Your Honor, I have no further questions. You're a witness, Mr. Prosecutor.
What were those documents you were looking for in Mrs. Wallace's desk? Were they false contracts you had written, checks you had forged, which could prove that you had stolen some $50,000? I must ask you to answer that question.
Yes, yes.
That will be all.
How do you feel this morning, Mrs. Wallace?
I'm all right.
You look tired.
Well, I'm having trouble falling asleep.
A murder trial can do that to you. I should know.
And that juror number 12.
Mrs. Bennett?
Yes, she keeps staring at me.
Are you sure?
Oh, I'm positive.
Well, it could be your imagination.
No, I don't think so.
It's not easy to be the key witness at a murder trial.
You mean it's normal for me to be so nervous?
Well, everyone's nervous. Some of us manage to hide it better. Now, let me look at you. Yes. Yes, your costume is just right. Properly subdued.
What? What is it?
Well, I'm not sure about that pin.
My butterfly pin?
It's just a bit flashy.
That's just what I said to him when he bought it.
Oh.
And in fact, we had quite a scene about it in the hotel. He really had no taste, never did. But he meant well.
What are you talking about, Mrs. Wallace?
What? Oh, nothing. Nothing at all. Are you saying I shouldn't wear this gold pin? Why, I wear it all the time now.
Oh, no, no. It'll be all right. After all, you're not the one on trial.
Mrs. Wallace, you told the police officers at the scene and testified here that the deceased, Mr. Aldrichton, came to your house to sell you some security.
Yes.
How well did you know Mr. Aldrichton?
How well?
Yes.
Well, I didn't really know him at all.
Are you saying that that was the first time you had met him?
Oh, he may have called on me at the office once or twice.
But the relationship you had with him, it was purely a business one.
Yes.
You knew nothing else about him?
No, not really.
And you were discussing an investment with him when you heard noises in the other room?
Yes.
Mr. Aldrichton went inside to investigate. There was a scuffle. The defendant shot and killed Mr. Aldrichton.
Yes.
Your Honor, I have no further questions.
Rosalind?
Mm-hmm.
Listening to Bach, are you?
Yes.
He would be your favorite composer. He's so mathematically precise.
Edward?
Yes, it's Edward.
What do you want?
Your plan was so simple, so logical. But it isn't going to work. They'll find him innocent. And you'll face the murder charge.
Oh, never. It's all over.
It hasn't even begun. Juror number 12 will attend to that. Mrs. Sarah Jean Bennett. You've seen her before.
I don't remember.
And she's seen you before. She's also trying to remember. Even now, she's sitting there in that jury room. It's bothering her. Suddenly, each of you will remember where you had encountered the other. It will occur to you both at the same time. And then it will be all over. She's trying to remember. Trying to remember.
Yeah, I've got all the votes from the jurors. Shouldn't take any time at all. Guilty, 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 guilty. And this last one makes it unanimous. Oh, what's this? Not guilty.
What's that?
Vote? Whose vote is this?
Mine.
Mrs. Bennett, you vote not guilty?
I do, Mr. Farnham.
Miss Bennett, the defendant, Alfred Graham, has confessed.
No, I don't believe him.
You don't believe him? His fingerprints are on the gun.
I don't care. I just don't believe him.
You don't believe he embezzled the funds and forged the checks?
Oh, yes, I can believe that. But murder? Oh, no.
Why not?
Because I look at him. Bless you, it's beyond him.
This is a court of law. We have to consider the evidence.
I have considered the evidence.
And?
I don't like it. I just can't believe it.
Returned by now?
Oh, yes, Mrs. Wallace, long ago.
Well, what's happening?
It's that one shot in a million I told you about. There's a holdout juror. It's 11 to 1 for conviction.
You know the juror holding out for acquittal?
And I'm sure I know who it is.
But why? Why?
Why, Mrs. Bennett? After all, we're all reasonable people. Tell us what you're thinking.
I don't believe the defendant committed murder.
Why did he confess?
Well, there's a missing piece here. I'm trying to remember something. To please everybody, bear with me for just a little while longer.
Rosalind, why aren't you asleep?
Sharp.
Oh, how sharp we have become.
What does she want? Stupid woman. Why is she holding out?
She's trying to remember where she saw you before.
Why would that make such a difference? What does it have to do with anything? Oh, I have to get some sleep. I'm losing my mind.
You lost it long ago when you killed me.
Alfred Graham killed you.
No. The jury will acquit him.
How? The evidence.
Mrs. Bennett will have caught you in a lie.
Lie?
And then the whole thing unravels. You will confess. You will have to.
What lie?
The lie that you told the district attorney.
I didn't lie.
You did. When he asked you how well you knew me, you answered, I didn't really know him at all. The truthful answer had to be, Mr. Allbritton and I had been having an affair for almost 7 years.
How could I say that?
Mrs. Bennett is about to catch you in that lie.
Oh, that name, I've seen it. I remember it. It was on a shop window in the hotel at Lake Merritt. Lady's Choice Boutique. Sarah Jean Bennett, manager.
Now, Mrs. Bennett, you must admit we have been very patient.
Now I remember.
What do you remember?
Please, everybody, just listen to me. About 7 years ago, I managed a boutique at a resort hotel at Lake Mallard.
Well, what does this have to do with...
Everything. It was a difficult store to manage. You see, I had bought some gold pins. It was a mistake. They said if I couldn't get rid of them, it would cost me my job.
Mrs. Bennett, are you all right?
I was fired because I could only sell one. And I just remembered that sale. A man had come in. It was a hard sell, but my job was at stake. The woman he was with, it was a kind of a place popular with unmarried people. Well, she led into him. I'll never forget how she called him a sucker and a fool.
Are you making a point, Mrs. Bennett?
I forgot all about it after all these years. And then in this courtroom, during this trial, I saw that ugly gold pin again. Now I remember the man who bought it. And the woman he gave it to, the man, was the murder victim, Mr. Edward Allbritton. And the woman, she was spending the weekend with him. I recognize her now. She was Mrs. Rosalind Wallace.
But Mrs. Wallace has testified that she hardly knew Mr. Allbritton, that their relationship was purely a business one.
Mrs. Wallace is lying.
Under oath?
Yes.
Rosalind, she knows.
Yes, I think she does.
She remembers, and they'll have to place you on the stand again.
Oh, I'm so tired.
I'll leave you now. You'll be able to sleep. Just close your eyes.
Mrs. Wallace? Mrs. Wallace? Wake up, hmm? What is it?
I rang and rang your bell. There was no answer. But the door was open, so I walked in. Oh, you're the police lieutenant. I was asleep. It was so good. It was so refreshing.
Yes,
I have instructions to bring you back to the courtroom.
Oh,
I see that gold butterfly is on your coat. I must confiscate it.
I know. I understand. I knew you'd be here.
You did?
How?
It's all finished for me, isn't it? I mean, once they check at places like Lake Maris, you know, prove I was there with Edward.
The silly man. Without it, she'd have never even thought about me.
You'd better pack a bag.
You see, I knew that Edward was trying to leave me, and I thought by wearing the butterfly pin, I would awaken certain memories.
Well, I did, but I awakened them in the wrong person.
But it's all right. Oh, it's all right. At least now I'll be able to sleep.
A pin. A sort of ugly gold pin. A store manager's mistake some 7 years before. Traps a murderer a long time later. Yes, even Shakespeare had something to say about fatal pins. Death comes at the last, and with a little pin, bores through the castle wall, and soon the king is dead. Meanwhile, I hope the juice will stay pinned to our radio till I return shortly. Salvador Dali painted a masterpiece which he titled The Persistence of Memory. Yes, memory. It stays with us always. We never really forget anything we've ever learned. True, it may become twisted and faded. It may lose its form and shape, and even its meaning. But it stays somewhere deep within us. When one day, for some reason, or for no reason, it bursts before our eyes in all its original color and brilliance and freshness. Our cast included Marian Seldes, Mandel Kramer, Lloyd Batista, and Joan Shea. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now a preview of our next.
You know what Anne had the nerve to say to me?
Henry, calm yourself.
Oh, to put it mildly, le majesté, huh? I made that woman, and I can break her. I was forced to marry her.
You'd have me believe that?
Yes, yes, her sorcery bewitched me, but it's all over. Over and done with.
It's because of young Jane Seymour, isn't it?
Well, might be. Well, she's a charming creature. I won't be punished if I marry her, I can assure you of that.
Your Majesty, who has punished you? Who would dare?
Ah, for a wise man, you talk like a fool. A man is denied a son. Is that not the Lord's displeasure and anger? Well, I shall marry a third time and please him and myself.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by White Westinghouse Appliance Company. This is Tony Grimes, inviting you to return to our mystery theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.